All right, Math 2, here we go. We got lesson 2.1.1, the triangle congruence theorems. Okay, so first of all, we've got on 2-1, we've got two triangles, and we're supposed to find the measurements of the missing sides for these triangles. We can tell that these triangles are going to end up being congruent to each other, but we'll get to that a little bit later. So if I'm missing sides and it's a right triangle, remember from previous courses, that you can use the Pythagorean theorem to find the third side. The Pythagorean theorem says that a squared plus b squared equals c squared, the hypotenuse squared. So we can do that. We can do 16 squared plus 30 squared equals c squared to find this side that we're just calling c right here. So 16 squared plus 30 squared should equal c squared. Remember, this only works with right triangles. So 16 squared is 256. 30 times 30 is 900. And that should equal c squared. And then 256 plus 900 is 1156. And then if I want to get c by itself, how do I get rid of squaring? Well, the opposite of squaring, the opposite operation is square rooting. So we would do c would be the square root of 1156. And that happens to come out evenly. If you plug it into your calculator, that's going to come out to 34. So we know that this last side over here is 34. And then over here, since this one's also 16, 30, and 34, those are going to match up there. Now remember, there are some shortcuts that you can use with the Pythagorean theorem. There were our Pythagorean triples. One of the triples is a 3-4-5 triangle. So Pythagorean triples are where all the numbers come out to integers. So 3 squared plus 4 squared does equal 5 squared. So that's a pretty common one that we see a lot. Another common one is 5-12-13. 5 squared plus 12 squared does equal 13 squared. And then a little less known one is the 8-15-17 triangle. So the 8-15-17 triangle is just saying that 8 squared plus 15 squared is 17 squared. Now technically what we're looking at down here is an 8-15-17 triangle. But all the numbers have been multiplied by 2. So if you know your Pythagorean triples, you can find your answers pretty quickly without having to do the Pythagorean theorem. Because this one over here is 8 times 2. This one down here is 15 times 2. So since this was 8 times 2, 15 times 2, this last side should be 17 times 2. And it is. It's 34. So it's an 8-15-17 triangle. Just everything has been multiplied by 2. And then there's another one, what is it, 7-24-25? Yeah, I think 7-24-25 is our last one. So these are shortcuts that you could use if you memorize the pattern, and then you can just double check to see if they're multiplying by the same number each time. So if we multiply everything by 3 on this one, 3 times 8 is 24, 3 times 15 is 45, and then 3 times 17 is 51. So a 24, 45, 51 would have also been a triple. So all these triple patterns can have all the numbers multiplied to make new triple patterns. So knowing your triples is actually quite helpful. Anyways, but you can always use the Pythagorean theorem if you want to do it the long way. Inside the triangle, we're missing an angle here. I've got a 90 degree angle and 28 degrees. But I'm missing this one. But from the last unit, we covered the triangle sum theorem, which states that all of these angles have to add up to 180 degrees. So the measurement of angle T plus 28 plus 90 has to equal, ooh, ran out of room, 180. Because all three of these interior angles have to add up to 180 by the triangle sum theorem. So this would be the measurement of angle T is equal to, plus 118 is equal to 180. And then I would subtract 118 from both sides. And I'd end up with 62 degrees. So that's the measurement of angle T. So this last angle is 62 degrees. And then on this other one, if it's 28, 90, this is also 62 degrees. So what we have here is two triangles that are congruent to each other. We know they're congruent because all the sides are matching up, 15, 30, 34, or sorry, 16, 30, 34, 16, 30, 34. All the angles are matching up, 62, 90, 28, 62, 90, 28. So they're all matching up. So we're supposed to write a congruent statement. In a congruent statement, the corresponding parts are written in order. So this one starts with angle T. Angle T is the 62 degree angle. So over here, angle G is a 62 degree angle. So G would go first because T corresponds to G. R is the 90 degree angle. Over here, A is the 90 degree angle. So A would come next. And then I, of course, is 28. And over here, N is 28. Now that you have the angles in order, all the sides are also in order. So the first two letters are TR. TR is 16. The first two letters are AG over here, or GA. And over here, GA is also 16. So now all the sides are matching up and all the angles are matching up. Last part for this, what transformation could map AGN to TRI? So we want to put them on top of each other. Whenever you're doing a transformation with two objects just kind of floating around, what you need to do is start matching up vertexes with vertexes. I always start with translations. It's usually easier. So step number one, I would translate triangle. I'm going to move this one over to here. Triangle GAN. And I want to match up angles with angles. So I would move it so that angle A is on top of R. So I'm going to slide this one until angle A is on top of R. So that angle A is on angle R. Let's draw a picture of what that would look like so far. So if we're starting off with this one, here I've got TRI. There's that one right there. And then over here, I had, this doesn't have to be perfect, but this is AGN over here. So my first step was to put angle A on top of R, and it's a translation. If we do a translation, this triangle should still be facing the same way. So after that translation has occurred, let's see how well I can do this. That's not too bad. All right, so my first translation, I took this point and I just moved it to the left and then down. And you can see that this triangle is still facing the same way. Okay, so that's step number one, I translated. Now we know from the congruence statement, let's see, this was G, and this is N, and this is, of course, A right there. So we know from the congruence statement that A and R are congruent to each other. That's why I put A on top of R. Now, the next thing I'm going to do is a rotation. So rotate triangle GAN. Now, I'm going to rotate it about this point because I want A to start to stay on R. So I'm going to rotate around that point so that G sits on top of T. All right, so I'm going to take this one, rotate it to put G on top of T. So rotate it about point R so that G is on T. So let's look and see what that would look like. If I take this and spin it around this point here, so I'm going to spin it around until G is sitting on T. If G is sitting on T, so here's G right here, here's AG, this part right here. This part would move to there, and N would rotate, and N would be on top of I. And then the triangles would be matching up. So all we have to do is do a translation, then a rotation. Now, sometimes after your rotation, they won't be matching up perfectly. So your last step will be that you need to reflect. And then they should be on top of each other. Three steps is the most you'll ever need. Start with the translation, rotate, and sometimes you're done. If you're not done at that point, if they're not on top of each other, last step, do a reflection. And they should be on top of each other every single time. All right, back from last year, you did triangle congruence theorems. Remember your theorems. There were five of them. Side-side-side theorem says that all the sides are congruent. If all the sides are congruent, the whole triangles are congruent. You don't even need to worry about the angles. Side-angle-side says that if you've got two sides and the included angle, so the angle that's right in between the two sides, if you have that, then that is enough to prove the triangle is congruent. You don't need the third side, and you don't need these two other angles. You just need a side, an angle, and a side, as long as the angle is included, meaning right in between the two sides. Angle side angle, kind of like side angle side, except now you have two angles and an included side, so the side right in between the two angles. That's enough to prove the two triangles are congruent. You don't need the other two sides. You don't need the other angle. All you need is two angles and the included side. This is the one that people get messed up on between angle side angle and angle angle side. The difference between these two, they both need two angles and a side, but the order of this one is different. Notice here, we've got our two angles, but this is not the included side. It's the non-included side. So if you have two angles and a non-included side, then you have angle, angle, side instead of angle, side, angle. Look at the difference between it. Sides in between the two angles, sides not in between the two angles. So that's the difference between those two. And then finally, our last one is HL. And HL is when you have a right triangle. So that's the first thing you need. And then you've got the hypotenuse and one of the legs. So 90 degrees, hypotenuse, leg. So that's HL. Remember, ASS does not work. Donkeys don't make triangles. So you can't use angle side side. That never works. And angle, angle, angle does not work either. It's only these five. Side, 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 angle, side, angle, side, angle, 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 side, and hypotenuse, leg. So let's move on. All right, 2-2. How do we know that these two triangles are congruent? Well, all they're giving us is the sides. So let's see if they match up. I've got 15. And 15. So there's one side that matches up. I've got 6, and I've got 6. There's a second side that matches up. And I've got 12, and I've got 12. I've got side, side, side for this one. Here's a side. Here's a side. Here's my second side. Second side. Third side. Third side. So we have side, side, side congruence. So we know they are congruent by side, side, side. Write a congruent statement. So this would be triangle. You can use any order for the first one. I'll just do NMP. Is congruent to triangle. Now this one, the order does matter because we have to match it up. Now N is the angle that's between 15 and 12. So I'm going to go over here. W is between 15 and 12. So N corresponds to W. M is between 6 and 15. So over here, U is between 6 and 15. So M and U correspond to each other. And then finally, of course, P is between 6 and 12, and V's between 6 and 12, so they correspond with each other. And there's our congruent statement. It has to be in order, because now this says that M is the same measurement as W. They're congruent angles. Angle M is congruent to angle U. P is congruent to V. All right, next one. Are the triangles congruent? If so, write a congruent statement. So let's see what we've got. We've got a side right here and a side. So there's a side. We've got a second side. And here's a second side. And we've got the included angle, the angle right in between them. So we do have side, angle, side. So yes, they are congruent by side, angle, side. So now we can do a congruent statement. The first triangle doesn't matter. I'll call it LRM. The second triangle does matter. L was the side that was marked congruent. So over here, that's going to be A. That's the angle marked congruent. Sorry, angle, not side. The second letter is R. R is between two tick marks and blank. So over here, C is between two tick marks and blank. So R and C correspond to each other. N is between one tick mark and blank. And over here, B is between one tick mark and blank. So ACB is what that's congruent to. Remember, the first triangle, it doesn't matter what order you put it in, but the second triangle has to match up to whatever order you've picked. All right, last part. We're going to state whether these are congruent triangles. So let's see what I've got. I've got 8, 70, 11. I've got 8, 70, 11. So that would be side, angle, side, side, angle, side. The angle is included for both of them, so that is going to work it. Side, angle, side. Congruent statement, triangle ABC is congruent to A is between 8 and blank, and F is between 8 and blank. So A and F go together. B is the 70 degrees, and E is the 70 degrees, so they go together. And then the last letter has to be D. C was between 11 and blank, D is between 11 and blank. Next one, I've got 12, angle, 16. Over here, I've got 12, 16, angle. That is not congruent, because this one is side, angle, side, but this one is angle, side, side, or side, side, angle. The angle is included for these two, but it's not included for these two. So the angle for side, angle, side has to be directly in between the two, so that one doesn't work. Now, this one looks like we don't have enough information, but using the angle properties that we found out in the last unit, we can figure out that this actually works. So here we have vertical angles, so I know that those two angles have to be congruent. And then I've got parallel lines, which I can show now that this angle here and this angle here are congruent because these are alternate interior angles. I've got parallel lines with the transversal. So I've got alternate interior angles. And now I have angle side angle, angle side angle. You could have also done angle angle side, because angle N and angle Y are also alternate interior angles. So you could have done angle angle side instead of angle side angle. You got choices on that one. So I'll do MNX is congruent to, so M goes with Z over here. N is the blank one, it goes with Y. And then these are the vertical angles, they're both X. Three more and then we're done. There we go. All right, for this one, we've got 90 degrees over here. Since this is a straight line, we can say that that's also going to be 90 there, because those are linear pairs and they have to add up to 180, so those are both 90. And then it looks like we only have two things, a side and 90 degrees, but we do have another thing that we can use here. This is what we call a shared side, the reflexive property. It's the same side on both triangles, so it is congruent to itself. So here I've got 90 degrees, hypotenuse, leg. So this is HL. So HL, remember, only works with 90 degree angles. And if you're looking at it, this is actually angle side side. That's a donkey. You don't want to write that down in your paper. But angle side side works in one condition. It works when you have a right triangle on it. So if I'm writing this up, I'll do ACD. So triangle ACD is congruent to triangle. A goes with A from the other triangle. C corresponds to B on the other triangle there. And D corresponds to D. All right. On this one, I've got parallel lines. So we can say that we have alternate interior angles. So that angle there and this angle there, they have to be congruent because alternate interior angles are congruent. We also have this shared side right here. So that's reflexive property. So now it does look like they're congruent because this is angle, angle, side, angle, angle, side. Remember, on angle, angle, side, the side's not directly in between the two angles. So we would call this angle, angle, side congruence. So if I'd had triangle EHF congruent to triangle E corresponds to G, they have the tick marks on those. H on the top one is blank, and H on the F on the bottom one is blank. So H and F correspond to each other. On the top one, the last letter is F, and it corresponds to this angle down here on the bottom triangle of H. Last one. All right, so for this one, we've got a shared side right here. So looking at this one, we've got angle side side. Angle side side does not work. That spells donkey. You don't want that on your paper. So that is not going to work. Remember, angle side side only works when you have a right angle, and then it's called hypotenuse leg. We never write donkeys on our paper. So this is not congruent. All right, that's all I got for you. Math hard. See you later. Bye-bye.